Yes, and you have books on Islamic epistemology. The case of Al-Ghazali and Fatawa Al-Ghazali. Imam Al-Ghazali was a great Islamic scholar, and he was also known as Hujjat al-Islam, Zawuniddin, which means the evidence of Islam, proof that Islam is a true religion. He was the Mujaddid of the Hijra 5th century actually. In his famous book, Ihya Ulumuddin, he explains that in the light of the verses of the Quran and the Hadith, why the brotherhood of Muslims is very important as follows. Don't get jealous of each other. Don't hold a grudge against each other. Don't say bad things to each other. And don't turn your backs to each other. Don't gossip each other. Servants of Allah, he brothers, Hujjat al-Islam al-Ghazali al-Ulumut al-Din. As academicians and people who address young generations, how can the Muslims could be encouraged for acting in union and becoming brothers, since not separating being like well-built walls is a commandment from Allah in the Quran? What should be done to educate Muslims on these morals of Islam?
It's a very, very important topic. And what do we do about the new generations of Muslims and others too? At one point, the Prophet ﷺ was sitting with his companions, and a man passed by, a Sahabi, a companion, and the Prophet ﷺ told his companions, if you'd like to look at someone who is destined for paradise, it's that, you know, that man. He did not say, he did not elaborate why this man was destined for heavens, for paradise. One of the companions followed this man to his house. And it was customary that people would spend 3 days, three nights, you know, as guests. And at the end, and it was also customary that the host would not ask why you are here. It was impolite. And after these 3 days, he did not see any extra. This man did not pray extra prayers. This man did not fast, you know, some extra. This man did not have extra almsgiving. In terms of appearances, there were practically nothing much, just a normal person. And this he asked him, that what is it that you do? This is what the Prophet ﷺ said about you. And he told him, the only thing that I do, before I go to sleep, before I go put my basically head to bed, I forgive all those who wronged me. Every night before he goes to bed, يتصدق بعرضه على الناس. And basically, whoever offended him, whoever gossiped against him, whoever hurt him, whoever basically, he forgives everyone before he goes to bed. And this shows basically a person who wanted to have a clear and a clean heart. He did not want to hold grudges against people. He did not want to have, you know, negative feelings, negative energy. It's a very beautiful tradition. Imam al-Ghazali, at the very beginning of the Ihya, he begins basically with the adab of both the teacher and the student. It was customary, because at the time they used to say, we teach adab before we teach the topic. Inshallah. And adab is basically, we talk about politeness, we talk about decorum, we talk about magnanimity, we talk about, you know, the best way to deal, you know, the teacher will be merciful to the students, and the students would have the utmost respect for the teacher. And that basically ethos has been lost. The students rebel, the students sometimes are obnoxious, they don't want to listen, each one thinks that he or she is the center of the universe, and precisely because many kids lost direction. The essential part about that which is right, I believe that every religion has, you know, it's almost like a Venn diagram. There is no religion that tells kids to be bad to parents. There's no such a thing. All religions ask children to be good to parents. And as a result, by extension, professors fall in the same category, etc., etc. But the idea, the adab, as it is said in Islamic literature, there is not much emphasis. There is emphasis on knowledge per se. There is emphasis on information. Of course you can gain information. You could be basically, you can make it not only to Harvard, it's not, you know, you can make it all the way to the best position intellectually, but ultimately the question is, did you gain adab along the way? Are you going basically to impart that adab, the good relationship with other people? And in fact, the law per se in the Quran, the verses about jurisprudence are very few. We talk about a couple of hundred verses. The rest is about faith and morality. It's basically the adab of the two women who walked, you know, in the story of Musa alayhi salam, Prophet Moses in Midian. She walked with still, she has that kind of integrity, that she still has certain level of shyness that is probably lost in the public sphere. Caring about others. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talked about caring. You know, it does basically make your heart tender when you take care of the orphans, when you take care of the elderly. When the two of the most prominent companions of Bakr as-Siddiq and Umar al-Khattab, they used to compete to serve an elderly woman in Medina. Look at this spirit. Here we have, they did not claim, you know, prominence in Islam meant then you serve more. Prominence, you are humble. Prominence meant that you are out there, you know, trying to help people, not only giving lip service to these values, but you lived. And this is what was about the first generation of Muslims when they were shaped by the Quran and by the Sunnah of the Prophet. The adab, the etiquettes, the politeness, the good manners, the, you know, everything was lived. You know, it is something that was experienced. It was not basically theoretical. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at one point passed by a man. The text of the hadith, مَرَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ بَرَجُلٍ يَعْضُ أَخَاهُ فِي الْحَيَاءِ, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed by a man who was telling his brother, do not be shy. And the Prophet told him, دَعْهُ فَإِنَّ الْحَيَاءَ مِنْ إِيمَانِ, leave him. It's okay to be shy a little bit. It is part of faith. So every time they tell people, don't be shy, don't, you know, just like encouraging people, because at one point they crossed the red line. We don't talk about being courageous in seeking that which is just, in seeking that which is wholesome. We talk about encouraging in the new generation to break, you know, the to go over the red lines and to venture into area where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to see them. In fact, if we just bring something from Ihya Ulumuddin, how Imam al-Ghazali reminds us of other aspects when he spoke about fasting. Usually fasting is abstinence from food and drink and intimate relation between spouses during the day of Ramadan from dawn until sunset. Imam al-Ghazali says that it is yet on a higher level. All your limbs should participate in this abstinence. Basically, your eyes should not seek that which is prohibited, which is now readily available on the internet everywhere, on your iPhone or what have you. Your ears should not basically listen to that which is prohibited. And where the tongue is doing something wrong, an ear is doing, you know, when the tongue is gossiping, someone else is listening. So the tongue should refrain, the ear should refrain, the eyes should refrain, the hands should refrain from reaching to that which is prohibited, which could be theft, it could be sexuality. The legs should not walk in the direction of that which is prohibited. So all your body is now abstaining from that which is wrong. And yet Imam Ghazali says, there's still yet at the highest level of fasting, of abstinence, is when your heart is abstaining from every other thing except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You try to dedicate, you try to remember, it's the dhikr. It's basically cleaning the heart, cleaning this chamber. And we don't talk about the physical muscle. Basically, when you are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and leaving everything, you try to do that which is good, but you are trying to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as possible.
Inshallah.
Inshallah.